Well, welcome to this edition of the 700 Club. For today's headlines, let's go over to the CBN News Desk.
Gordon, the attempt to blow up a jetliner on Christmas Day is raising serious questions about how vulnerable the U.S. still is to terrorism. Jennifer Wishon looks at what wasn't done to stop the latest attack and what may be done to stop future ones.
U.S. intelligence officials had the information they needed to stop 23-year-old Umar Farouk Abdulmutallab from boarding a U.S.-bound plane on Christmas Day, but didn't connect the dots, according to the president. Now critics want to know why the terror watch list system allowed Abdulmutallab to keep his American tourist visa and board a plane with explosives taped to his underpants.
At the airport, we provide very little attention to the passenger himself. We focus almost all of our efforts to what he carries.
The incident is raising serious questions about the future of airport screenings, and the debate over religious and racial profiling is intensifying.
100% of all the terrorist attacks against the United States last year were carried out by Muslim jihadists. So if that's the one common denominator, let's include that in the mix.
Some senators are questioning the way the Obama administration is handling the situation.
Her comment that there was no evidence of a wider conspiracy is just plain wrong.
Meanwhile, a homegrown terrorist plot is moving through the justice system. Another Muslim man who said he wants to start jihad in Memphis goes to court in a few weeks for allegedly threatening to blow up several businesses in that city on Christmas Day. Jennifer Wishon, CBN News.
In other news, a Vermont judge has ordered a Christian woman to transfer custody of her 7-year-old daughter to her former lesbian partner. Lisa Miller, the biological mother, conceived Isabella while Miller was living with Janet Jenkins. Miller left Jenkins after becoming a Christian. They've been fighting for custody of Isabella ever since. Last month, the same judge awarded Jenkins custody of the girl. Miller sought a delay in the transfer until an appeal could be heard, but the judge said no. He says Isabella has to be turned over on January 1st. Mexico City has legalized same-sex marriage. That makes it the first city in Latin America, and the largest in the world for that matter, to approve gay weddings. Lawmakers there say they partly did it because they want to boost tourism from homosexuals. But this issue is dividing the strongly Catholic city, with one pro-family group calling gay marriage, quote, total depravity. North America's next generation of missionaries is meeting this week in St. Louis, Missouri. They're part of InterVarsity's 22nd Missions Conference called Urbana. Heather Sells has more from St. Louis.
More than 16,000 students have descended on St. Louis from across the U.S. and Canada. Their purpose, to learn more about missions and God's calling on their lives.
Well, I think at Urbana what you find is a large number of students who are serious about their faith. They're serious about how their faith intersects the global needs.
Today's young people are thinking about missions in new and fresh ways. They're concerned about social justice issues as well as evangelism. And they're thinking about how to reach emerging communities such as Muslims and gays.
You know, one of the things that we found is that college students are the most hungry group of people to really learn what it means to build bridges with the gay and lesbian community, because it is getting thrown in their faces. 5 days out of the week, 8 hours a day on the campuses.
More than 1,000 young people packed Marin's seminar on reaching out to gays. His focus, helping students find ways to dialogue with gay friends instead of cutting them off. Thousands more are choosing seminars on social justice issues like poverty and AIDS. For many, it's a unique opportunity to learn more about global needs and where they might fit in.
There's a lot of need, especially with like refugees.
I just wanted to get some focus on what the next step was and also get to hear from other people that have kind of gone before me.
InterVarsity leaders say they'll challenge students to commit this week. For some, it may actually be a first-time decision for Christ. But for many others, it will be a commitment to missions and wherever that takes them.
We're going to see a generation of students called into modern-day missions. At this convention, from the platform, the seminars, the exhibit hall, you're going to see students make the decision that will lead them throughout the course of their lives to a lifelong commitment to missions.
Reporting in St. Louis, Heather Sells, CBN News.
And those are our top stories from CBN News. Gordon and Terry, back with more of the 700 Club in a moment.
Bob Lozier here for Newsmax Magazine. Things happen in the world every day that you should know about. So doesn't it make sense for you and your family to own an emergency radio? In fact, federal and state agencies advise you to have one. It's essential for severe weather, power failures, even terrorism. Now Newsmax Magazine is offering you an emergency radio absolutely free. The World Band Emergency Radio is durable, picks up all major and shortwave frequencies. It even works without batteries. Just pay shipping and Newsmax will send you this radio free, plus a free trial subscription to Newsmax Magazine. The award-winning Newsmax covers the people and the politics, the news that affects our country, your family, with insights from great writers, and the latest in health and money you need to know. Newsmax gives you the other side of the story without the media spin. Make sure your family has the emergency radio. Get it with our free offer. Call now, 800-NEWSMAX, 800-NEWSMAX.
I didn't think it would happen to me. It was an aggressive type of cancer. It was growing, and I thought, am I going to die?
I will never be the same.
I needed someone to take me by the hand and walk me through this fight for my life. A commercial came on for this hospital that treats cancer. Within a week, we were walking through the doors of Cancer Treatment Centers of America. The nurses and the doctors are kind and considerate. They said, we're going to get rid of the cancer and we're going to make you strong. You're not a number. You're a person that has cancer. You're looking for hope. You're looking for life.
Call now and we'll send you this free DVD that shows you how the most compassionate group of people anywhere puts you at the center of everything we do. Advanced medical treatment combined with unique supportive therapies give you treatment options you may not even know exist.
There's life after cancer, and it's a full life. It's a great life.
Bruce McElwain was out of work, and his wife, Bobby, had a job she didn't like. Between them, they could barely pay their bills. So they put their heads together and found a way to quadruple their profits.
We just didn't make enough to make ends meet year-round.
Bruce McElwain couldn't make a living as a subcontractor installing gas fireplaces.
It was feast or famine. It was very busy during the early fall, and then as soon as everybody got their units installed, it was famine time. It was very frustrating.
Bruce spent his days trying to drum up business while his wife Bobby worked long hours at a job she didn't like. Then, Bruce's priorities dramatically changed after he discovered the 700 Club and Pat Robertson.
Prove me of this, says the Lord.
Pat was teaching on the principle of tithing, and up to that point, we had just given God tips, like a dollar, maybe two. It really awakened me to a completely new principle.
Bruce told Bobby what he learned about tithing.
I didn't feel it was right to give 10% of that money I'd worked so hard for at a job that I really didn't care about doing much.
Bobby says God began changing her mind through scripture on tithing and through a new church with the same message. Meanwhile, while Bruce was installing fireplaces, an idea started forming in his head about opening a new business.
He would come home frequently and tell me that the customers would complain to him that there was no one that did it all, who would sell the product, install the product, run the gas line, and do the electrical.
So we decided to open a retail shop. It was a very big step. We prayed endlessly about it because I wanted to be sure we were doing what God wanted us to do.
They both agreed to tithe faithfully to CBN and their church. And their new business called Hearth and Home immediately turned a profit. As their profits increased, so did their giving. They rapidly moved up the different levels of CBN until they joined the Chairman's Circle, and their business continues to grow. Hearth and Home's profits have quadrupled since they opened in 2001.
I've seen our business go from here to here, and there is no other explanation for that other than God.
You can't outgive God.
You can hear the story again and again and again, and it still is incredible what God will do when you just take the time to obey, to say, okay, these aren't just words on a page. These actually have meaning, and they have meaning for my life. And if I obey them, then God will do what he promised to do. Here it is from Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 18. Remember the Lord your God, for it is he who gives you power to get wealth, that he may establish his covenant which he swore to your fathers as it is this day. God gives you the ability. He gives you the power to get wealth. He gives you that ability so that you can go out and make it happen. Now, he has lots of creative ideas, and he will give creative ideas to you. He'll give you new innovations. He'll give you new inventions. He'll give you new methods. He'll open your eyes to see, here's a need that I can meet. And in that process, he gives it freely, the ability to get wealth. Now, what's the precondition for it? Well, it's remembering him. It's putting him first. And the Bible says very clearly, the purpose of tithing is to teach you to put God first in your life. And when you do that, then you can fully expect that the blessings of God will flow down. He'll give you those same creative ideas. What he's done for others, he will do for you. Now, it's up to you. It's up to you to put it first, to remember him, and then the blessings flow. Then that covenant blessing will flow to you, and he will open the windows of heaven and pour out blessing you cannot contain. Let today be the day you say, okay, I'll try this. I'll let today be the day where I say, okay, I will start the tithe today and test God in it and see that he will honor his promises to you. Terry?
Well, when Mariani gave birth to her first child, it should have been one of the happiest days of her life. But soon after that, her husband walked out, leaving her alone with no money, no job, and a son who was crippled.
4 years ago, Rizal was born with a condition commonly known as clubbed feet. Surgery would normally occur soon after birth. But Rizal's mom was raising the boy alone. Her husband had abandoned them.
He came once when Rizal was a few months old, and the only thing he said was, "How is he going to wear shoes?" Then he left us again.
Mariani wondered if her son would ever walk or run normally. She knew her meager income could never pay for the surgery the boy needed.
I cried a lot. I would tell Rizal to stay strong and be patient. Maybe someday someone will help you.
That someday came about 6 months ago when a neighbor told Mariani about an organization called Operation Blessing. Operation Blessing provided Rizal with the two surgeries he needed to repair his feet, and with the extensive physical therapy he needed to learn to walk properly for the first time. Finally, Operation Blessing provided the boy with a pair of orthopedic sandals.
I am really thankful to Operation Blessing for bringing healing to my son. I am really grateful that Rizal is walking normally like other kids. May God return your kindness. Thank you, Operation Blessing.
You know, that story, I think, so eloquently states the difference that you and I can make when we're willing. When we're willing, when we have a heart to do the things that are on God's heart. And God invites us to be a part of that. We want to invite you today to join with us because we hear God's invitation, we see the need, and it is our desire to be out there making a difference in the hearts and lives and minds of people all around the world who may not know the love of Christ, who may have a situation like Rizal's, where they simply don't have the means to do anything about it. We can make a huge difference and show the love of God at the same time. If you'd like to be a part of that, join the 700 Club today. It's so easy to be a part of the family of ministries that reach out around the globe from here every day and hug people with that kind of help and with the love of Jesus. So call now. Say, I want to join the 700 Club. We welcome you. You can know immediately that you are touching lives and making a difference. Gordon?
Well, up next, a state trooper sends out an SOS.
And the second I finished that transmission, the man was leaning into my car and he fired 4 bullets into my left lower back at point blank range.
See how this cop survives and what happens when he meets his shooter the second time around.
Yeah, buddy.
How many nickels are in a dollar?
There are 20 nickels in a dollar.
How do birds fly? Does milk really make my bones stronger?
Yeah.
Daddy, when we die, will we go to heaven?
Do you have the answer to life's biggest question? Call the 700 Club. We'll help you find answers to the important questions life brings your way.
All I read about is more government spending. I don't know where the money's coming from.
And first we have a recession, and now they're saying we may have inflation. There just doesn't seem to be any place to turn.
Well, it's clear we need to rethink our investment strategy. And it seems a lot of people are adding gold to their portfolio. Maybe we should.
Why gold?
Gold can be a hedge against inflation. It will help diversify our portfolio, and you'll like it because it's a physical asset.
Yeah, an investment that we can see and touch.
Right.
That's appealing to me.
Sound familiar? Are you ready to take the next step and add gold to your portfolio? Then I recommend you do what I did. Call Goldline and speak to an account executive. They'll walk you through the steps to get started and answer any questions you may have. Goldline has been helping people diversify their portfolio with gold for 50 years. Call Goldline now. Get your free investor's kit and learn why you should own gold.
Ever since he was a boy, Steve Watt's dream was to become a policeman. It was a dream that ultimately came true and one that nearly killed him.
It's promised to be a slow day for Wyoming State Trooper Steve Watt. He had planned to spend the day catching up on paperwork at the station. Meanwhile, an armed man robbed a savings and loan in nearby Craig, Colorado. At last report, he was spotted driving a red sports car along the Colorado-Wyoming border. Steve joined the search, even though he wasn't wearing his bulletproof vest as he usually did. It turned out to be the one day he would need it.
I started south of Rock Springs and come across this little brown compact with Colorado plates, and I decided I'd stop him and ask him if he'd seen this bank robber in the sports car that I was looking for.
As it turned out, the reports of the car's description were wrong, and Steve had caught up with the fugitive.
It all happened so fast. He slammed on his brakes and his door pops open. So I hit the latch on my door, still trying to call in, and he's out of his car and he's pointing a gun at my windshield and he fired 2 bullets into the windshield. The first one came through the windshield and hit me in the left eye, and the second one ricocheted off the windshield. So I threw myself over in the front seat to get out of the line of fire. I'd kicked my door open and I reached down and grabbed for my radio mic to call in that I'd been shot. And the second I finished that transmission, the man was leaning into my car and he fired 4 bullets into my left lower back at point blank range.
The pain was staggering, but Steve managed to get out of his car. As the felon's car pulled away, Steve opened fire.
My first bullet hit the little metal bar in the headrest, right in the center of the back of his head, and ricocheted down and hit him in the left shoulder, knocked him forward and to the right, which knocked him out of the way of the next 5 bullets, which would have hit him in the chest cavity and killed him. So my first bullet saved his life.
The shooter tried to escape on foot, but was apprehended by other officers. Steve lay on the side of the road, critically wounded.
I was not a Christian at that point in my life. But I said a prayer right at that point in time, and the exact words of my prayer were, God, I don't know if I'm going to die. If I do take care of my wife, Marion, please help me.
Doctors were stunned that the trooper was still alive. The first bullet entered Steve's left eye, stopping the thickness of a piece of paper from his brain. The second ripped through his stomach, intestines, and liver. The third shot stopped in his spine, nearly severing his spinal cord. The fourth and fifth bullets tore through his abdomen. 3 of the 5 wounds should have been fatal.
When I woke up in the intensive care, they told me that the doctors had removed my eye, and I started hating the man who shot me. It was like a cancer. It was just taking over. Every morning I'd get up and I'd look in the mirror to shave, and this empty eye socket would be staring back at me. It was a constant reminder.
Steve had horrible nightmares, depression, and anxiety. Still, he felt compelled to go back to work.
The job was different now. It wasn't a dream anymore, it was a nightmare. I was afraid of the public. It didn't matter whether they were a man, woman, a teenager. I was afraid that everybody that I stopped was going to shoot me. And I hated the man who shot me for taking away the job that I loved.
Steve, who was no stranger to alcohol, drank even more and started taking painkillers.
My wife had said to me before we got married that if I ever turned into an alcoholic, she would divorce me. And I turned into an alcoholic, so I would get drunk to the point of passing out, and then I'd get up and I'd take all my beer cans across the street and put them in my neighbor's garbage so my wife wouldn't know how much I was drinking. I was taking lots of painkillers, and I had terrible headaches.
Steve's depression deepened.
One night while I was drunk, I took my service revolver and I stuck up my mouth and I was going to kill myself. And in the nightmares, in my hatred and my anger and my bitterness right then, and I thought about my wife, and I thought to myself, you've already put her through so much, how could you do this to her? And I put the gun down and I never thought about shooting myself again.
Steve's struggle was far from over.
One night, right at dusk, I stopped this vehicle for speeding, and the guy jumped out of his car. It was just like the shooting all over again, and I saw that he had a gun in his hand. It was a .44 mag with a 6-inch barrel, and I drew my revolver, and I started to pull the trigger, and I focused on his hands, and it wasn't a gun, it was his billfold.
That night, Steve Watt's career as a state trooper came to an end.
Find out what happened next when we come back.
Diabetes scared me to death. There's so much to learn. I just shut down. But Liberty walked me through it all. Like, when I test at night or after I eat, makes a big difference.
A good diet and testing your blood sugar regularly can help you manage, even reduce, the risk of complications. That's why Liberty offers AccuCheck Aviva Meter that lets you test right the first time. If you're over 65, have diabetes, and are on Medicare, call now and we'll send you a free meter. It offers alternate site testing so you can test on your arm. No more pricking your fingers, so it's less painful.
It makes a big difference.
And to make it even less painful, the cost of your diabetes testing supplies may be covered by Medicare. Join over a million others who have chosen Liberty Medical. Call now and receive a free AccuCheck Aviva meter. Plus, for a limited time, get a free cookbook when you join.
Call 1-800-406-6965. 1-800-406-6965.
Less than a year after he was shot in the line of duty, Steve Watt returned to his job as a state trooper. His physical wounds had healed, but the shooting had left him with a shaky trigger finger. So when he stopped a speeder one night, he panicked. And at that moment, a man's life and Steve's career hung in the balance.
I drew my revolver and I started to pull the trigger and I focused on his hands, and it wasn't a gun, it was his billfold. And I almost killed the man that didn't deserve to die. I almost killed him because he had a billfold in his hands. I drove straight to my sergeant's house and I told him I'm done.
It had been almost a year since the shooting. Steve's wife, Marion, also a police officer and an atheist, still marveled that her husband had survived.
Over a period of 9 months on the graveyard shift as a police officer, it gave me a lot of time to think. You know, the bullet that stopped the thickness of a cigarette paper from entering his brain, the bullet in his spine, and he could still walk. And it took me about a year to finally say, well, maybe there is something out there that this isn't coincidence.
Marion took her questions to the police chaplain, who told her about Jesus Christ. One night she asked Jesus into her heart, but she didn't tell anyone, not even her husband.
He knew me as this strong atheist, and I had started carrying around this New Testament that the chaplain had given all the police officers because I had such a thirst for knowing this God.
As Marion's hope and faith in a savior grew, So did Steve's anger and bitterness toward the man who tried to kill him. His name was Mark Farnham, and he had been sentenced to life in prison.
At that point in time, the way the sentencing structure was in Wyoming, a life sentence was average of 12 years. And I was very, very bitter about that, that in 12 years he would be eligible for parole.
Steve moved from job to job, still suffering from the physical and psychological wounds from the shooting. Marion saw how miserable her husband was, so she told him how her faith in Jesus had changed her life.
She said, you know, I'm a Christian. I was baptized today. And I said, well, I said, that's neat. I said, maybe I ought to be baptized too. Maybe it'll help me. And she said,
wait a minute. There's a little more to it than just being baptized.
So we went over to the chaplain's house, and she's praying, and the chaplain is telling me about Jesus as my Lord and Savior. And it made sense to me. I sit there and I thought to myself, you know, if Marion can believe this, it's got to be true. And I accepted Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior.
Steve had a new faith, but he held on to the anger and bitterness.
That was something that I was not going to turn loose. It was too important to me. To turn loose of the anger and bitterness made what happened to me less. And I wasn't about to allow that to happen.
Steve couldn't understand why Marion's life had changed and his didn't.
I was so miserable. I called the chaplain who had led Marion and I to the Lord and asked him why Marion was so happy and I was so miserable. And he said to me, have you forgiven the man that shot you? And I said, of course I have. And he pretty much called me a liar. I think I probably even hung up on him. And another week or two went by and I just couldn't take it anymore. I was so crushed with such a heavy burden that I called him back and I said, what do I do? And he said, why don't you write him a letter?
Steve did. He told Mark that he had become a Christian and that Jesus had changed his life.
It was amazing when I wrote that letter. It was just like God reached down and picked this semi-truck and just lifted it off of me. I actually enjoyed opening up the Bible and reading scripture. I felt a need to go to church. I wanted to go to church. It was such an amazing feeling to have that burden gone.
The two began exchanging letters, and Steve eventually visited Mark in prison.
Is there one particular incident where I can say I truly forgave him? I think it was a growth process for me.
Steve and his family visited Mark often and prayed for him for years. Then in 2003, Mark got into a scuffle with another inmate and was put into solitary confinement. There, he cried out to God.
Well, in the hole, I said, okay, things aren't working my way. It's a mess. My life's a mess. I need help. So I got down on my hands and knees in the hole there, and I prayed. And I knew at that moment that Christ had come into my life and things would be different.
Okay, it's good to see you.
Yeah, it's good to see you, buddy.
Forgiveness is a choice. It's a conscious choice. And as a Christian, I say I believe in Jesus, and I believe in the things that he teaches, but I'm not willing to forgive the man who shot me. Jesus forgave me, and it was my sins that put him on the cross.
It was only by the grace of God that I was saved and that Steve was saved, because I didn't want anything to do with God. I didn't believe in him, did not want to have anything to do with him, preferred his name not even mentioned. And it took something as traumatic as being shot 5 times to wake us up. Don't wait to be waken up by something that is that traumatic. He's touching everyone on the shoulder. Try to recognize that touch.
He's touching you on the shoulder as well. He's touching everyone. And he says it very clearly, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hear my voice and open the door, I'll come in. I'll sup with them. You can literally know him. You can have a relationship with him. You can call to him and he will answer you. He will talk with you. He will reveal things to you. Now, what is it that blocks us what is it that prevents us from seeing him, from hearing him, from having this relationship with him? Well, the Bible's really specific about two main areas. One, sin. It's your sin that separated you from God. So if you're having trouble hearing his voice, if you're having trouble seeing him in his word, if you're having trouble even seeing him in creation, the Bible's very specific that creation declares the glory of the Lord. If you're having trouble with that, you need to start examining yourself and saying, well, what is it in me that stops the revelation? And keep in mind, Jesus is always knocking. He's always communicating. He's always reaching out and touching. He wants a relationship with you so badly. He loves you so much that he was willing to die for you, to take the penalty for all sin, for all mankind, for all time. And he did it for you. Now, what's the second thing that blocks it? Bible's real specific. Unforgiveness. If you have aught against any, stop praying. Leave your offering. Don't even bother to continue. Go make it right. Go forgive. And then when you do, you'll find that that big truck has been lifted off your shoulders, that weight, that thing that blocks you. Two things, real simple. Don't make relationship with God hard. It's not. It's very simple. It's very basic. We want to get very elaborate with things. We want to have the right ritual, the right thing, the right way. It's not that at all. It's all about your heart, what you desire, what you want to do. Now, some of you, you're ensnared in sin. Jesus is very specific about that. Sin makes you a slave. And you continue to do the thing that you don't want to do anymore. You continue to do it. Jesus is very specific about unforgiveness. It blocks the grace of God. It blocks the forgiveness of God from flowing in your life. Now, if you want to get rid of this, if you want to see him clearly, if you want to have joy again, peace, a clean heart, if you want to have these things, then come to Jesus. Open that door to him. Let him know. Let him know how much you want him in your life. And when you do that, he'll come in. He'll make you new again. There's no sin he's not willing to forgive. There's nothing you've done that he can't cleanse. All you have to do is look to the cross and let that be the author and the finisher of your faith. Let Jesus, what he did, let that encourage you. And let his act of forgiveness from the cross, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. As he was being beaten, as he was being crucified, his forgiveness flowed. Let it flow into you. Let it transform you. Let it change you. It will be the best decision you've ever made. You can have newness of life. I came that you might have life and have it more abundantly. And all it takes is for you to ask for it. For you to take two simple steps. Father, forgive me. Cleanse me. And then two, forgive others. Whatever's happened to you, whatever other people have done to you, let it go. Forgive them. And if you'll do these two simple things, your eyes will be open, your ears will be open, your heart will be new again. So if this is for you, right now, just bow your head with me, pray a very simple prayer. And let Jesus do all the rest. What he's done for others, he will do for you. Pray with me. Lord Jesus, that's right, say it out loud. Lord Jesus, I come to you today, and I ask that you would set me free, that you would forgive me of the things that I've done wrong, that you would make me new again. And Lord, right now, I forgive anyone who has ever done anything to me. I set them free. I don't want to hold anything against them. So Lord, out loud I say, I forgive them and I release them. Now, Jesus, I ask you, come into my heart. Make me new again. Give me joy. Give me peace. Give me the peace that passes all understanding. For I ask this in Jesus' name. Father, for those who just prayed, I pray a baptism in love. I pray a baptism of acceptance, that you would open their eyes and open their ears and open their heart and let them know that they've been forgiven. Do it now, Lord, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. The Bible says, if you believe in your heart, then confess with your mouth, you shall be saved. What I want you to do is go to the phone, make a toll-free call, 1-800-759-0700. Just say, I want to confess with my mouth that I just made Jesus Lord of my life. If you have anything that you want specific prayer for you, we're there for you. So call us, 1-800-759-0700. We also have a free packet for you called A Higher Calling. There's also something special. If you're having trouble with forgiveness, and many people have trouble with this, we've got another pamphlet on forgiveness. It'll give you specific steps, what you can do to make sure that you don't have anything against anyone. It's all free. All you have to do is call us, 1-800-759-0700. Terry, over to you.
Up next, Christy's in the kitchen with Master Chef Rick Tremonto.
Muscles? Okay,
oh
see how the muscles
goodness,
are?
How good that looks!
Look at that. Isn't that beautiful?
Okay. Where's my fork?
Okay, we're getting there.
How to make this dish from start to finish when we come back.
I know how it feels to be alone. To be hungry.
To be afraid.
I haven't had a birthday party.
My own room. Or a family to call mine. I'm an orphan.
An orphan.
An orphan.
And there are 100 million more like me in the world today.
Together, you and I can make a tremendous difference to someone today. We can change the lives of orphans. I'm asking you to get involved. Give to Orphans Promise. From Asia to Africa, from Latin America to Europe, you'll be providing housing, food, education, job training, and hope to children who are alone and at risk. Jesus said, whatever you do for the least of these, you do for me. Please give to Orphans Promise and love a child today.
Hi, I'm Dr. Joyce Brothers. Those of us who are independent and live alone shouldn't do so without having emergency protection. And for reliability and peace of mind, I recommend Alert USA.
With Alert USA, if you ever need assistance, just press your pendant to be connected to an operator who can summon help to your home 24 hours a day.
I've been giving advice for many years, and I believe Alert USA provides the best emergency support and value for your dollar. Call now for a free brochure.
Welcome back to the 700 Club. Senator Ben Nelson's decision to vote for the health care bill is hurting him badly with Nebraska voters, although he won't face re-election until 2012. If Nebraska Governor Dave Heineman runs against Nelson, he holds a lead of 61% to 30% in a new Rasmussen poll. Only 17% of Nebraska voters approve of the deal Nelson made to support the health care plan. A new intelligence report says Iran is trying to smuggle in massive amounts of raw nuclear fuel. Iran is reportedly trying to acquire purified uranium from rogue officials in Kazakhstan. The Islamic regime appears to be running low on that nuclear material, so it's planning to pay $450 million for 1,350 tons of it. That would violate UN Security Council sanctions on Iran. You can always get the latest from CBN News by going to CBN.com. Gordon and Terry back with more of the 700 Club right after this.
Notice anything? No? That's the idea. I have unwanted facial hair. What, you thought you were alone? That's because we all try so hard to keep it a secret. But now it's easy with Vanica. It's not a hair remover, it's a prescription cream that's clinically proven to reduce the growth of facial hair in women.
Vanica's given me the freedom to be close to people again.
Vanica is gentle. Use it along with your regular skincare routine. It works deep within the follicle, blocking the enzyme essential for hair growth. It's dermatologist recommended and FDA approved.
I started seeing less facial hair within a month.
I'm so glad I asked my doctor about Vanica.
It's safe to use and it doesn't have the potential to scar damaged skin like removal methods do. The most frequent side effects associated with Vanica are mild and skin related.
Unwanted facial hair? With Vanica, nobody needs to know.
For more information and a free rebate of up to $60, call or go online now.
It's the best decision I ever made.
The Chicago Sun-Times called him, quote, a blend of mad scientist and magician. Celebrity chef Rick Tremonto has been dazzling his customers and critics for almost 25 years. And recently, Christy Watts joined Rick in his Chicago kitchen to find out why.
Chef Rick Tremonto has received worldwide acclaim for his diverse and creative cooking style. Well, I recently had the opportunity to cook up something special with him at one of his four new restaurant venues outside Chicago.
What's your specialty? Like, what's your favorite? Is it Italian? Is it seafood?
It's so funny. I grew up learning Italian. I grew up in the culture of Italian. But I went to Europe to learn French and Spanish and fine dining. And now I find myself, like, I love grilling.
Really?
Like, I come home, throw up the grill, throw up some steaks, you know.
Grilling, that's
American
thing.
Cash stuff. I like the cash
stuff.
Yeah,
cool. Okay, so what are you going to cook for us today?
So we're going to, you know what we're going to do today is we're going to do an old world recipe called mezza rigatoni with mussels and asparagus. And a mezza rigatoni, I want to start here.
Right.
You know, normally rigatonis are about this big. So a mezza rigatoni is like a mini rigatoni.
Okay.
So I'm going to have you cut up some asparagus that we blanched in some salt water and shocked, kind of chilled it all down.
All right.
Nice.
Look,
you've been watching Food Network.
Come on,
nice.
Okay. Is that good?
That's perfect. We're going to take a little bit of extra virgin olive oil.
All right.
We're gonna throw it in the pan and be generous. Don't be shy with the olive oil.
And olive oil is great because it's also heart healthy. Did
it
you know
is
that?
Heart healthy.
Loved it.
So, hot pan. We're gonna throw a couple tablespoons of onion in there. I love that. Hear that?
I love
just
that.
Just for television. A little bit of garlic, about a tablespoon of garlic. We're gonna. You like garlic, right?
I love garlic.
Nice. See, 30 years to do that.
I know. Come on.
Come on. So we're going to sweat that. That means we're going to kind of slowly pull out the juices and all the flavors of the onion. We're also going to throw a little bit of red crushed chili pepper in there.
Ooh.
Just to spice it up a little.
Yeah, I like the spice.
And all the oils from that chili is going to kind of start to bleed out of that.
Okay.
Then I got these beautiful Prince Edward Island mussels, which are fantastic.
Yes.
Yeah. We're going to throw those right in there.
This is fascinating because this is something that I don't know. But I noticed that the mussels are all closed, but I guess when you start to cook them and steam them, they start to open
they'll
up?
They start to open. They'll start to release all their juices.
How do you know when they're done? Is it when they open up?
I'm going
to
show you.
Oh, fabulous.
A little bit of dry white wine, just enough to start to steam them. Hear that? Nice, huh? And now they're going to start to steam. They're going to all those juices are going to start to kind of come together. We're going to throw a little lid on top. While that's steaming, we're going to come over here. We're going to start to cook our rigatoni. I got salted water going. About a half a pound of rigatonis in there that are going to start to cook.
And the mistake that I think people make all the time is, how do you know when your pasta is done? How do you know when it's al dente?
Well,
did you know I was Italian?
You're beautiful Italian. Perfect Italian.
That's the only Italian word I know.
Here's the thing.
Okay.
My mom used to throw it against the wall and see if it sticks. No.
But you can't do
She's
that.
She used to bite it.
Yeah.
And if you see that little, see how it's perfect? See that right there? See how it's a little bit white in there?
Yeah.
Taste. That's perfect al dente. It's got that perfect little pull to it. Perfect, right? Mussels. Okay, you see how the mussels are?
How good that looks.
Look at that. Isn't that beautiful?
Okay. Where's my fork?
Okay, we're getting there. We're getting there.
I'm ahead of the game. You're the cook. I'm the eater.
We're going to toss these mussels around. We're going to throw in the asparagus that you cut up.
Oh, my goodness.
And you know, the other thing is right now is it's everything's in season. Everything's starting to explode in season. So those are going. And I love citrus. I love to cook with citrus. So I'm going to throw a little bit of lemon in there for some acid. And I'm going to throw a little bit of orange in there for a little bit of sweetness. Very heart healthy. I pull back on a lot of the salts and the fats, and I use a lot of citrus in my cooking to bring out flavor, and it's fabulous.
I cannot wait. I tell you what.
So we threw a little bit of tomato in there.
And you know, one of the things that my mom always taught me was it's all about presentation and color, because you eat also with your eyes, not
you
just
do.
With your mouth.
So
I know she got the greens and the reds and the garlic.
So we got our pasta in there. Beautiful. Okay. When you're cooking and you're using some pasta water and it's really seasoned and it's got some starch and
some
oil.
Do you season the water?
I put a little salt and pepper in. I put a little oil in because I use the water almost as part of my sauce. Watch. Right? Nice.
Mm.
And we're also going to add a little bit of chicken stock just, again, to coat the pasta. And a little bit more sauce.
Now I'm curious. Mm-hmm. Obviously, it is okay to mix the different stock. So if it's chicken stock but with a seafood, that's okay?
Oh, absolutely.
You don't need like a vegetable stock
no,
and a,
you
a
know
seafood
what?
Stock?
I find that chicken stock is one of the most neutral stocks to use. Okay. And it will pick up all the residual flavors of the mussels. Look at those. They're beautiful.
Oh, my goodness.
You know, and if you have clam stock at home, use clam stock. If you're going to all that trouble to use... to make fish stock and put it in your freezer, by all means.
Okay.
You know, for me, the richness, the depth of some of the chicken stocks that I get at the store, the low sodium stuff, it's just a great neutral flavor that works really, really well.
Okay.
And it'll
butter.
Pick up on the acid.
Now, I'm all about the butter,
just a
little bit.
Just a little bit. Just to kind of bring the sauce together, just to kind of bring this whole thing together.
You're making me happy, Rick. You're making me very happy.
It's all good. We're going to just steam this for just another second.
Okay. I always wonder this. When you're at home and you've cooked all day, do you just say, let me bust out a peanut butter and jelly sandwich? Or even with your peanut butter and jelly sandwich, is it it's presentation? We got a little parsley on the side.
You know what it is I'm a tuna fish sandwich.
Are you really?
I travel all over the world like I'm sure you do. There's two things that I judge on, BLTs and then tuna fish sandwiches. You know, I love tuna
easy
fish sandwiches,
simple.
Right? Toasted tuna fish sandwich, some potato chips, right?
Yeah,
isn't that funny?
I love that.
Like...
Hey, simple.
Okay, here we go.
Oh, my goodness.
Nice. Smell. Nice.
Oh, my Lord.
Okay.
Little things make me happy. This is a big thing, and I'm thrilled.
As they should.
Oh, my goodness.
As they should. And the asparagus and all the mussels. And again, all the juice of the mussels. And you see how the butter kind of brought that sauce together?
Goodness. Incredible. You know what's so pathetic is I'm sitting there looking, and you do everything with such ease that I'm so confident. I'm like, I could so do this at home. But I know it would not look as beautiful.
I don't believe you. I don't believe you. I bet you do great at home.
I do all right.
Look at that, huh? Nice.
Looks phenomenal.
Now, we're going to just do a little bit of olive oil to finish. And a little bit more basil.
Fresh. Now, what's the difference, obviously, between fresh and the dry? I would take it the fresh.
Well, there's no comparison. The fresh
greater.
Is vibrant. Here's what I always say.
Yeah.
If you put this in your hand, watch, and go like this, right?
Yeah.
That says it all, right? There you go. Dig in. Grab a muscle.
Okay. All right. I know you're married, but I could still kiss you right now.
She'll get over it.
I know. Oh, my goodness. I love this. Okay, now, just out of curiosity.
Yes.
How do you determine what you're going to cook?
It really becomes focusing on what God has given us and what the farmers are producing, when they're producing it. I always, always pray before I start to write my seasonal menus, and I always try to get inspiration from the other parts of the art, like music, church, love going to the museum and seeing this beautiful Monet or Dali, and I get inspired by that. So I pull from different areas and just reading, you know, reading the word and watching what, you know, looking at what Jesus ate and fish and vegetables and being inspired and going and doing some research in those regions.
Why do you think people have such a taking to your cooking, to your presentation, to your style? What is it?
I think it's honest cooking. Like, everything needs to be in balance, but full of flavor, like lots of concentrated flavors, and they can trust that it's going to be the real deal. That's what it's about.
Well, I vouch. It is the real deal. Brother Man is the bomb. High five. All right. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Doug.
Couldn't you just taste it as they were doing that? Wow, it looked wonderful.
Brother Man is the bomb.
Really. If you'd like Rick's recipe for mezza rigatoni with mussels and asparagus, you can log on to CBN.com for that recipe. And for more of his great recipes, you can get a copy of Rick's book called Fantastico, and it's available nationwide.
I tell you, I'm going to Chicago just for a trip to,
really,
to his
I
restaurant.
Really, I think it's well worth it.
Rhonda Bifford is a personal trainer who loves lifting weights. She's also an artist and a musician. So when a painful cyst began to interfere with her work, she went into action. And in the time it took to watch a TV commercial, Rhonda was on the road to recovery.
I first noticed something starting to form on my wrist in late 2003. I went to my doctor, and she said that it was a ganglion cyst, and I had never heard of one until then. She didn't say anything how to get rid of it or, you know, so I just kind of started to live with it. In 2005, it kind of changed. It was quite large. It was bigger than the bone on my wrist, and it became hard and started to become painful in my wrist and in my forearm. The pain was more like just kind of an annoyance. It wasn't something that, oh, I'm in pain, I need to run to the doctor, but it was just, you know, just something that was frustrating to deal with. I love to lift weights, and it was bothering my range of motion in my left wrist. And so, and on top of that, it wasn't too attractive. I just kind of would hide it with my other hand usually. One day I received Pat's book, Miracles, in the mail because I'm a member of the 700 Club. And I started reading a lot of his stories. They just taught me how you can command things, that we have authority in Jesus' name. And he also taught about how Christ, when he prayed for people, he never asked if it was God's will. He always said a command, peace be still, or, you know, get up and walk. So it was about 2 weeks later, and I was sitting on my couch, just watching TV one night, and I was having pain in my wrist. And I put the television on mute during a commercial. And then I simply just looked at my wrist and I said, by the authority given to me through Christ, I command you, get out of my body. And then I put the TV back off mute and my show was back on. It was about 5 days later, I looked down at my wrist and it was half the size. And I got a little excited. I thought, wow, something's going on here. This is good. And so I spoke to it again. 2, 3, 4 weeks later, it was completely gone. There was absolutely no sign of it, and it's never been back. You know, I don't have to worry about pain in my arm and hiding my cyst, or, you know, just being frustrated because I don't have my range of motion there. You know, I don't have to worry about being in the gym and having problems, or just, you know, doing anything. I feel like I have more power that I never knew about, power to take a hold of those promises that I have in Christ.
The authority of the believer. These signs shall follow them that believe. They shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover. Now, you've got to get past the point where you've got questions about God's will. Is it God's will to heal or not? Get through that. Get to the point where you see in heaven there's no one sick. God's will is being perfectly done in heaven. It's on earth that we have the troubles. That's why Jesus told us, pray this specific prayer, that thy will would be done on earth as it's being done in heaven. When you get that idea and you finally understand that, then you start to understand disease is illegal. These things shouldn't be happening. They're against God's will. And it's because we've allowed sin into the world, and we've allowed disobedience, that we're not seeing Him perfectly, hearing Him perfectly, understanding Him perfectly. It's because of our own going astray that these things are allowed to occupy our thoughts and minds, and we start to get into these strange theological conundrums. Is it God's will or not? Keep it simple. Keep it the authority of the believer. And when you come to Him just as a little child, and Jesus says that clearly, unless you have the faith of a little child, when you come to Him as a little child, just saying, okay, I'll do this. It may not make sense, but I'll just do it because Jesus said I could. When you get to that point, you have all the faith you need. You don't need a lot. Just need a little mustard seed. When you've got that, you can release the awesome power of heaven, and you get to speak it into being, and you get to say it to whatever it is. Jesus never prayed for the sick. He always commanded it, and it happened. And the amazing thing is, God has given you that ability. Now, it's my favorite time of the program, where we get to lift up your needs. What I want you to do is to join with us in an act of faith. Lay your hand on that area of the body that needs healing. And then I want you to do something else. I want you to speak to it. And not some vague question, God, if it be your will. But realize the authority that's already been given to you and speak it into being. And say to your disease, say to your infirmity, be gone. And say it out loud, not the silent prayer, say it out loud. And together, let's watch what happens. The Bible says if two or more agree, touching anything, it shall be done. So Terry and I will agree, you join with us, and together, let's see what God can do for you. Pray with us. Lord God, we just come to you right now, and Lord, just as little children, we come and we believe in what you've already done. We look to Jesus on the cross and we claim that scripture that by his stripes we were healed, that it's already happened, that by his sacrifice all our sins have already been forgiven and all our diseases have already been healed. So Lord, right now we just say, may your will be done in these bodies. And together we speak to them and we say, disease, you must leave now. Infirmity, you have no right to this body. You must leave right now. There's a man, you're praying for your left knee and you just spoke to that knee, work. You had pain in it. You had swelling in it. God is healing you right now. Stand up and do what you couldn't do before.
Somebody else, there's a cerebral hemorrhage involved either in your life or a loved one's. There's been pooling and swelling, and God is healing that condition with no existing problems left behind.
If you've been touched, we want to share in your good report. So call us, 1-800-759-0700. We leave you with these words from Psalms. He will command his angels concerning you to guard you in all your ways.
We want to say thank you to the thousands of you who recently pledged to join the 700 Club. You've saved lives, fed the hungry, healed the sick, and brought hope to hurting people here at home and around the world. Just like you did for Miriani and Rizal. Miriani's son Rizal was born with clubbed feet. Abandoned by her husband, she was left alone to care for her son, knowing she could never afford the medical help he needed. That's when you came and provided the two surgeries for Rizal. You also gave the physical therapy that's helping Rizal learn to walk normally. You even bought the orthopedic shoes Rizal required. You completely changed the present and the future for this family. Your monthly gift makes it possible to preach the gospel and demonstrate the love of Jesus to millions each year. Please watch for this mailing and send in your pledge. When we stand together, we can change the world.
And it only happens
because you were there.